year 399, Saint Jerome sent a letter to Oceans. It's an eulogy of Fabiola, whose life had come to an end a few months before that. And next to this, to his letter, Jerome sent another one addressed to Fabiola. Jerome fulfilled his old promise in it, and he tried to explain the deeper meaning of the Jewish exodus from Egypt with the support of allegorical interpretation. Fabiola, the addressee of this posthumous letter, had not belonged to the circle of ladies in the Mount Aventine, of which Jerome had been a spiritual leader. But later she had become such a devoted adherer of ascetic lifestyle propagated by Saint Jerome that she visited him in Bethlehem. Fabiola had been very curious about the meaning of different parts of the Bible, and Jerome noted down their conversation about the sacred scripture. Suddenly she made up her mind against the advice of all her friends to take ship and to come to Jerusalem. Here she was welcomed by a large concourse of people and for a short time took advantage of my hospitality. Indeed, when I call to mind our meeting, I seem to see her here now instead of in the past. Bless Jesus, what zeal, what earnestness she bestowed upon the sacred volumes. One day we had before us the Book of Numbers written by Moses, and she modestly questioned me as to the meaning of the great mass of names there to be found. Then unrolling the book still further, she came to the passage in which is given the list of all the halting places by which the people after leaving Egypt made its way to the waters of Jordan. In a word, I was ashamed to refuse her request and allowed her to extort from me a promise that I would devote a special berth to this subject for her use. Till the present time, I have had to defer the fulfillment of my promise, as I now perceive by the will of God, in order that it should be consecrated to her memory. As in a previous work, I clothed her with a priestly vestment, so in the pages of the present, she may rejoice that she has passed through the wilderness of this world and has come to at last to the land of promise. In Latin, only the last sentence, I'm quoting in Latin, extorsit mihi negandi verecundia, ut proprium ei opus huius cemodi disputatium ule polvicerer, ut usque in presens tempus, ut nunc intelligo domini voluntate dilatum, reddetur memoriae illius. Ut sacerdotalibus prioris ad se voluminis induta vestibus, per mundi huius solitudinem gaudeat se ad terram repromissionis adiquando venisse. The allegorical interpretation of literary texts had a long history among the Greeks and the Romans. Also, this method of interpretation was highly estimated by the Stoics. It was also criticized by some philosophers, like, for instance, Plato, who composed the dialogue on the relationship between the names and their meaning, which, according to the Stoics, could be decoded with the aid of etymology. From as early as the 6th century BC up to the Hellenistic period, different forms of allegorical interpretation occurred. Such forms could be, for instance, historical, rational, natural, ethical, or theological, etc. interpretations, which were sometimes based on the etymology of names, attributes, and stories about gods and goddesses. Due to a significant impact of Hellenistic text interpretation forms on the Mediterranean cultures, neither the Romans nor the Jews could avoid the influence of the Greek allegorical interpretation. An interpretation of the Exodus from Egypt can be found in the Bible as well. Psalm 77 gives an ethical interpretation of the Exodus, but it's not a real allegorical interpretation. aperiam in parabola os meum elo quar propositionis ab initio. Furthermore, the psalm uses a metaphor which probably served as the first crucial point toward the allegorical interpretation of the Exodus. Still, I would like to underline the fact again that the psalm emphasizes only the importance of God in the destiny of chosen people. It doesn't provide an allegorical interpretation. From this point of view, and according to the communist opinion, Philo of Alexandria was the first and one of the most influential Jewish scholars who tried to interpret the stories of the Bible in an allegorical way, and he was the first who presented an allegorical interpretation of the Exodus in the sense of the Greek allegories. Philo also used the tools of the Greek allegorist, and to help him in his allegorical interpretation, he often turns to the interpretation of numbers and to etymologies. For instance, he defines words by breaking them down into their component parts and by redefining them. See, for instance, what he claims about the Exodus' deeper meaning as follows. And Moses also, of all those who sacrificed the Passover, praised those who sacrificed first most, because they having crossed over from the passions, that is to say, from Egypt, remained by the passage, and didn't hasten anymore to the passions which they had quitted, and so on. And I quoting, I mean, doesn't quote the quote the whole passage. René Bloch summarizes Philo's point of view like this. The Exodus is nevertheless important to Philo. He reads the story allegorically as a journey from the land of the body to the realms of the mind. Such a symbolic reading permitted him to control the meaning of the Exodus and to stay literally and figuratively in Egypt. Concerning the history of allegorical interpretation within the Christian community, it's likely that at the time of Jesus Christ, the Jewish interpretation of the Bible was influenced by the Hellenistic allegorical interpretation adapted by Philo of Alexandria. Jesus himself must have known allegorical interpretation. Paul, the apostle, however, was one of the most important protagonists of allegorical interpretation of the Bible. Many passages of his writings demonstrated that he had known the former interpretation attempts very well. One of his famous remarks claimed that the littera occidit spiritus autem vivificat, which later became a basis for Christian hermeneutics. In the epistle addressed to the Corinthians, he presented the still Christian interpretation of the Exodus. During the early century of Christianity, this interpretation determined the later allegorical interpretations. On the basis of St. Paul's view, Origen goes further in the interpretation in his fifth homily on the Exodus. I quote, but I show you only the words of St. Paul, and thereafter Origen. Let's see, however, what sort of rule of interpretation the Apostle Paul taught us about these matters. Writing to the Corinthians, he says in a certain passage, "For we know that our fathers were all under the cloud, and all were baptized in Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. And they drank of the spiritual rock which followed them, and the rock was Christ." You can read the text as well on the slide. And the next interesting passage: "The children of Israel departed," the text says, "from Renascens and came to Sukkot. And they departed from Sukkot and came to Etam. If there is anyone who is able to depart from Egypt, if there is anyone who desires to forsake the dark deeds of this world and the darkness of errors, he must first of all depart on, from Ramesse and to follow Christ. And another interesting point of his interpretation. But we can also apply these words another way. If you flee Egypt, if you leave behind the darkness of ignorance and follow Moses, the law of God, should the sea hinder you when the waves of contradiction rush against you? Strike the opposing waves with the rod of Moses, that's the word of the law, and by vigilance in the scriptures open a way for yourself by disputing with the adversaries. As you can see, Paul the Apostle gives a Christian theological allegorical interpretation of the whole story. This way out this Exodus is an allegory or prefiguration of the Baptism and Christianity, a way out from the Old Testament into the New. The rock is Christ himself, and the Jewish people who went across the Red Sea are those who were baptized in Christ's name, the Christians. According to Origen, Egypt is the darkness of ignorance, and the rod of Moses is the word of the law and the vigilance in the scripture. This interpretation fits neither Philo's nor St. Paul's views. The Alexandrian scholar interprets the whole story as a philosopher's journey, winning over his passions. The apostle explains the Exodus as the release of a Christian from the captivity of old law. By Origen's story can be understood as an allegory of a Christian apologist's life. Being aware of St. Paul's and Origen's interpretation, Jerome gives an allegorical interpretation of Exodus, which is focused on the narrative of the way out and on the names of its stations. It's well known that Jerome was studying in the famous grammarian Aelius Donatus school in Rome. Donatus, his teacher, was not only a schoolmaster of his time. He composed a commentary to Virgil's poem and to Terence's comedies, and in addition to this, he wrote an Ars Grammatica. His commentary on Virgil is no longer accessible, but we can still consult his writings titled Life of Virgil. In this biography, Donatus describes how Virgil started his career as a poet. First of all, at the age of 28, Virgil published Bucolics, which took him 3 years to master. Furthermore, Donatus calls his readers' attention into the fact that Virgil then worked 7 years on the Georgics and finally 11 years of the Aeneid. Focusing on the amount of time necessary for Virgil to complete this verse, we can compose a line of number of the same in the two-dimensional pyramid. I will show you only the numbers in the biography of Virgil. 1 plus 2 equals 3, 3 plus 4 equals 7, and 5 plus 6 equals 11. There are some other symbolic elements in Donatus' Life of Virgil, but I will focus on the numbers first, which can be interpreted as a scheme influenced by the numerology of the Pythagoreans or the Neopythagoreans. Donatus might have seen symbolical perfection in Virgil's life, and I think that Jerome must have been influenced by his Pythagorean symbolism. What's more, this is the point where one of the most important differences between Origen's and Jerome's allegorical interpretation can be demonstrated. Philo and Origen, following the Jewish interpreter, viewed the Exodus as transition. Jerome, however, gives an explanation of the mentions as if they were parts of a curriculum vitae, a biography. At certain points he makes a correlation between the number of the stations and the respective stage period of life. At the 30th mention, he mentions that a 30-year-old man can be considered perfect because Christ was the age when he started teaching publicly. Ut cum per venerimus ad perfectum virum in sacerdotalem gradum et in etatem plenitudinis Christi. After this clarification, we can easily understand his statement about the special attributions of the number 28. Si ab uno incipias numero, et paulatim ardens ad septimum usque perennias, vicesimus octavus efficitur numerus. There is a contradiction between the Pythagorean system used by Aelius Donatus and the Christian interpretation based on the New Testament. According to Jerome's idea, the Exodus is the representation of the life, of the verus habeus, that's the true Christian person. The name of the mentioned Getabata means goodness, and so this meaning is linked to Christ himself, who is the good shepherd. Pastorem in bonus conit animam suam pro ovibus suis. The verb itself would not have been enough to mention Christ's age at the beginning of his public life, and Jerome is the only one who uses the numbers to emphasize the age at important points. In addition to the above, in Jerome's interpretation, the departure from God during the crossing in the desert is an allegory of the departure from the church during the life, after baptism until this. At mention 17, Jerome presents the following explanation. Ex quibus discimus in itinere istius vitae et de aliu in aliu transitu, nunc nos crescere, nunc decrescere. Et post ordinem ecclesiasticum sepe ad laterum opera transmigrare, siem in post profectum rursum ad luti opera descendimus, infremandi sumus et cursus vagi ad perpetuitate scripturarum retinaculis dirigendi. If you realize how turbulent the use Jerome had and how complex his relationship to the church was, we might fix the hypothesis that the Verus Hebraeus, the true Jew of Jerome, has some features of the saint himself. Taking a closer look at the allegorical interpretation of Exodus in letter 78 to Fabiola, we can see contours of a person who in the 80s went to the land of promise, and he was living still in Bethlehem in 399. But he is not the only person whose use can be described as turbulent. In the previous letter, Jerome mentions Fabiola since she divorced from her first husband and then married again. But after her second husband's death, she started a long penitence. As Jerome summarizes, she came down like the daughter of Babylon from the throne of her daintiness. She took the millstones and ground meal. She passed barefooted through rivers of tears. The above-quoted end of Jerome's letter present a direct link between Fabiola's life and the meaning of the Exodus. As Jerome writes, as in a previous work I closed her with the priestly vestments, so in the pages of the present, she may rejoice that she has passed through the wilderness of this world and has come at last to the land of promise. Per mundi huius solitudinem gaudeat se a terram repromissionis aliquando velisse. According to this passage, Jerome had also seen the Exodus as an allegory for Fabiola's life. If we look at the allegorical interpretation, we will contemplate a diptych of the writer and the addressee. To sum up, I would like to highlight that Jerome's interpretation was definitely based on the earlier Greek, Roman and Christian tradition, but he also went much further to write his autobiography. Thank you very much for your kind attention.